Now, I'm going to speak today on this thought, the touch of the Master's hand. I said to Paul in the study there before the service, I said, son, I'm going to speak today on the subject, the title of the touch of the Master's hand. He said, well, I have that song already placed here. I intend to sing it today. So the Lord was leading him, no doubt, as he led us to bring this message on the touch of the Master's hand. Now, the singing and the message will be on cassette tape. It will be tape number 142. We have many other cassette tapes. We send them out for a gift of $3 each. And the money is used to help pay for radio time. This past Friday, we completed 36 years of daily broadcasting from the classic city of Athens, Georgia. That's 36 years daily broadcasting. I was talking to a fine young couple you're visiting with us today, and the gentleman said to Preacher Edwards, I've been hearing you on the broadcast. I appreciate that. We have several young couples with us yet today visiting with us. We appreciate it. And many times people hear us on the radio and they come to hear us in person. I appreciate that. And having been on the air for 36 years daily, that lets you know this is not a fly-by-night ministry. We're now in our 37th year. We went on the air on the 1948, on the first day of September 1948. And someone said before we went on the air at that time, said, you'll never make it in Athens. It's been tried by great men of God, and they have never made it by faith on the radio stations with the gospel program. I said, if God's in it, God will see that I stay on. And that was 36 years ago. I've been on daily ever since. God's people has kept me on the air. This radio ministry is of the Lord. And this radio ministry have kept me in Athens all these years. Had it not been for the radio broadcast that God put me as a watchman on the wall here on the radio station, then of course I probably would not have been here but just a few years when I came to Athens. But every time I thought about leaving, seemed God spoke to me and said, son, I put you on the radio. I mean for you to be a watchman on the wall and continue on. So all these years I've been here, and the radio broadcast is responsible. And there's people in heaven today because of it. There's people in the ministry today because of it. There's missionaries on the field because of this broadcast. And people are doing Christian work because of it. Four churches have been established as a result of the radio ministry. And we give God all the glory, the praise, and the honor. And the people, you that love God, that's kept the program on there, has made it possible. I can't do it by myself. God gave the word, great is those that publish it, saith the Bible. And we work us together in getting out the gospel. And I do believe with all my heart, when we come to the judgment seat of Christ, you that's kept us on the air financially, and prayed for us, and stood by us, and encouraged us, will stand with us at the judgment seat of Christ and be rewarded there at the judgment seat of Christ for your part in this ministry. God keeps a record. He has a record of every dime you've given on this broadcast. And God keeps a record, and you'll face it again at the judgment seat of Christ. I want you to pray for me and write to me. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. And if you'd like to have one of our brochures on our proposed Holy Land tour for next year, you request the brochure, we get it in the mail to you. This will be trip number 12 for me, the Lord willing. And it's a trip of a lifetime. I always look forward to going every year. And it's such a blessing. I wish I could carry everybody. I'd like for every Christian to go. And if you could go, it'd be a real trip of a lifetime. If you had to borrow the money to go on. If you'd like to have one of these brochures, request it, we'll send it to you. I'm speaking on the touch of the Master's hand. Many times you can just touch something and it, of course, turns out to be valuable. I know a minister in the ministry today. He's pastored for a number of years. And his wife prayed earnestly for him to get saved. And he was the type of fellow you couldn't go back and try to persuade him to come to God. He resented that. And she got him to go to church one night. And they heard the preacher preach, and when they did, during the invitation, she didn't do a thing to worry about, just reach over and touch him on the back of his hand. He had his hand on the back of the pew. And when she touched his hand, he started out. She followed him to the altar. That's all she needed. All he needed was just that touch. He came to God. He's been preaching the gospel now for a number of years. And just a touch sometimes, and he wonders. There's a man following his little boy one day and came to electrician where a wire had been broken down from the the electric pole, and it was a live wire. And this little boy reached out and just touched that wire, and he was burned and died suddenly. And his father reached out and touched the boy, and he was killed instantly. So sometimes by a touch, many things happen. Man told me one time about going to a mental institution. Said that he went into this mental institution for the first time and saw a man standing there with a butcher knife. And said that man started toward him, and he didn't know, thought the man might be wanting to attack him. And so he started walking away, and the man kept walking toward him. And he started running. The man ran after him. He ran as fast as he could run. The man right behind him with that butcher knife. And he's just about exhausted. And said, well, I can't run much further. And he came to a tree, and he climbed the tree, and the fellow climbed the tree behind him. And he went out on a limb as far as he could go, and the fellow came out on a limb behind him. And when the fellow caught up with him, he reached over and touched him and said, now you're it. So sometimes you can't ever tell what might happen in a touch, you know. But I want to talk today about the touch of the Master's hand. Reading from Luke chapter 18, if you care to turn there. Luke chapter 18, beginning with verse 15. Luke chapter 18, beginning with verse 15, page 1101 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. And they brought unto him also infants that he would touch them. But when his disciples saw it, they rebuked them. But Jesus called them unto him and said, suffer little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child shall in no wise enter therein. Now if you notice here in verse 15, that they brought these children to Jesus that he might touch them. They wanted the Son of God just to touch the child. And they brought their children in, urging and urging their way through the crowd in order to get the child to Jesus, just wanting the Lord Jesus to touch him. The touch of his power over the enemies of a human family. These people knew if Jesus ever put his hand upon their children, they should be all right. Everything Jesus touched was changed. His touch had power over whatever he touched. Now he put the devil to flight. He put disease to flight. And he raised people from the dead just by a touch. I want to mention some of these things today. And as I bring the message, I want you to ask yourself the question, have I been touched by the Lord? Have you been touched for salvation? Or have you been touched for power? Now, number one, his touch is a life-giving touch, according to the Bible. We find that Jairus' daughter died, and she was touched by the Lord and raised up. In Mark chapter 5, verses 41 and 42, and he took the damsel by the hand, and when he took her by the hand, of course, he said, I say unto thee, arise, and straightway the damsel arose. Now, here we find the Son of God came to this girl that had been sick, and she died, and he just merely took her by the hand. And when he touched her, when he took her by the hand, she immediately arose. There she came back to life again. The same thing happened to the widow of Nain's son in Luke chapter 7, verses 14 and 15. And he came and touched the bier, and they that bare him stood still. And he said, young man, I say unto thee, arise. And he that was dead sat up and began to speak. Now here we find another person raised from the dead by the touch of the Son of God. You can see why that mothers would push through a crowd, bringing their infants to the Lord Jesus, that he just touched them. Just lay his hand upon them, put his finger upon them. That was very important. And because his touch brought life here to people that were dead, when he touched them, they came alive again. Then number two, his touch is a cleansing touch. By the touch of Jesus Christ, many people were cleansed in his day. The lepers were cleansed by the touch of Jesus. In Matthew chapter 8, verses 2 and 3, and behold, there came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Leprosy in the Bible is a type of sin. When God saved you, God touched you by his power and cleansed you from all of your sins. Here in the leper camp, people were not allowed to go in, of course, because of leprosy being so contagious. And of course, when they found out they'd contracted leprosy, then they had to stay a certain distance from anyone. And if someone came near them, they would cry out, "Unclean, unclean, unclean." And that meant you could not go near anyone that had leprosy in those days. But not the Lord Jesus. He went to the man, and the man came to him. And the Bible said the Son of God touched him. Just reached out and touched this man that had leprosy. And the moment he did so, he was healed immediately. Because Jesus was very God and very man. He was a God-man. And he touched the man that had leprosy and cleansed him immediately. Didn't take all day for him to do this. It happened suddenly. And when God touches you, when God touches you for salvation, beloved, God can save you immediately. It doesn't take a day or a week or a month for God to save you, not even an hour, not even a minute. God can save you in the matter of seconds if you mean business. If you come to God repenting of your sins, receiving him by faith, the touch of God can come into your life and you can be made whole, and God will blot out every sin that you've ever committed since the time you came on this earth's planet. God can cleanse you from all of your sins, not just some of them, but all of them. You may say, "Now, Preacher Edwards, I've been kind of rough in my life." I don't care how rough you may have been, how mean and ungodly you may have been. Our God can touch you and cleanse you from all of your sins, every last one of them. The Apostle Paul said he was a chief of sinners. He went about persecuting God's people, bringing them to jail, giving consent to be put to death. And he was a murderer, and God cleansed him from all of his sins. And you know what happened to the Apostle Paul, how God used him mightily. We come to thought number three. His touch is a quieting touch. Jesus healed Simon Peter's mother-in-law of fever. The Bible said she had a fever, running a temperature very high, no doubt. And Jesus went in and quieted that fever. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 8, verses 14 and 15, when Jesus was come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother laid and sick of a fever, and he touched her hand. He touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she arose and ministered unto them. Now he just merely touched her hand. She was a sick woman, and she came into Simon Peter's house. Simon Peter was a married man. He was never a pope. Never was Simon Peter a pope. Simon Peter here was a married man. And there the woman, the brother Jesus came into his house and touched his mother-in-law, just merely touched her. And there she was healed, and immediately she got up and went about ministering to Jesus and those in the house. She was completely healed, completely well, feeling good. And she said, "Let me get up from here and get busy and help to take care of these people." And she ministered to them. This healing is a type of sin, sickness, and discomfort. I may be speaking to someone today, you're sin sick. You've tried everything the world offers. Maybe you have a terrible headache today because you stayed out late last night and drank beer, wine, or whiskey. And you're sick today, you're sin sick. But I'll tell you now, there's one that can take care of you in that respect and make you feel comfortable again, and that one is the Lord Jesus. And so he made this woman comfortable. He took care of her illness and straightened her out. Jesus can do that, and he will do that if permitted to do so. We come to thought number four, and that is his touch is an illuminating touch. We find the Bible tells us Jesus opened the eyes of blind men that followed him. The Word of God tells us in Matthew chapter 9, verses 27 through 30, and when Jesus departed thence, two blind men followed him, crying and saying, "Thou Son of David, have mercy on us." And when he was come into the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said unto them, "Believe ye that I am able to do this?" They said unto him, "Yea, Lord." Then touched he their eyes, saying, "According to your faith be it unto you." And their eyes were opened. Here Jesus touched their eyes, and their eyes were open. I've seen it on TV. I don't waste my time looking at this fake ministry of these so-called divine healers, racketeers. Sometimes have people come in and gouge them in their eyes and gouge their fingers in their ears and pop them upon their forehead and shake them around and all that kind of fake stuff. Beloved, I don't believe that. That's not of God. God's not in that kind of tommy rot. But when Jesus touched them, they were healed immediately. Now, if these fake healers had healing power, they'd let nobody leave blind. They'd open their eyes and so forth, but they don't have it. One of the rank leaders of the healing racket said the other night, Sunday night, a week ago, I just happened to turn on the TV, and he was on. He told one of his big lies. He said Jesus came to his room there in the hospital in the Faith City, and Jesus came and talked with him 20 minutes, and then the angels came and joined in on the conversation. That's another one of his big lies. He tells those lies to get money out of people that send him money believing that stuff. And beloved, that's pathetic. That's pathetic. And a man, a lie like that, Jesus Christ has not appeared to him or anybody else since the days of John the Beloved and the Apostle Paul, and will not until he comes at the rapture. I don't care how many lies he tells to get money out of people. It's just lies. And the Bible said the devil is a liar and the father of lies. So you take it from there. Jesus touched these people, and that touch opened their eyes. We come to thought number 5, and that is his touch is a reassuring touch. A reassuring touch. Disciples felt that touch on the Mount of Transfiguration. Jesus went up on the Mountain of Transfiguration. It's a real high mountain, one of the highest mountains in the Holy Land. I've been on top of that mountain myself. Very high mountain. Jesus went up there with 3 of his disciples. And while he was up there, something happened. In Matthew chapter 17, verses 6 through 9, and when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were so afraid. And Jesus came and touched them and said, "Arise and be not afraid." So on the Mountain of Transfiguration, there the glory of God came down, and there came Moses and Elijah. And the disciples, Peter, James, and John, were very much afraid. They were greatly disturbed. There they were on top of this great mountain. And there the glory of God came down. And all of a sudden Moses and Elijah came down and scared these apostles half to death seemingly. And Jesus just reached over and touched them. That's all he needed to do. He just touched them. He touched them and said, "Be not afraid." Now, why did Moses and Elijah come down to talk with them there on the Mountain of Transfiguration? Why? What did he talk about? The Bible said they talked about his crucifixion in Jerusalem, his death, burial, and resurrection. They came down and there encouraged the Son of God and talked about his death, burial, and resurrection. Moses and Elijah. Why Moses and Elijah? One represented the law, the other represented the prophets. And there'll be the two witnesses that will come back in Revelation chapter 11. They're coming back to this earth. You find them mentioned together in many places. Malachi, the last chapter. You find the names mentioned. You'll find them here on the Mountain of Transfiguration. And they will be coming back, and they'll be killed there in the streets of Jerusalem. The bodies will lie there in the streets for 3 days. And TV cameras from all over the world will be focused on the bodies of Moses and Elijah. And they will not allow those bodies to be moved. They want the whole world to get a good eye of what happened, because the Antichrist will want the world to think he has all power. And there when Moses and Elijah is put to death in Revelation chapter 11, the TV cameras are being focused on their bodies for 3 days. And then all of a sudden they'll rise up, and people all over the world will see them. That is the people that's left here at the rapture. You'll be in heaven. You might not see it, and yet you may, but you won't be on the earth. And people from all over the world will see them as they get up on their feet. After they've been dead 3 days, they're in the streets, street of Jerusalem. And then after they get up on their feet, they're going to start rising up like Jesus did on the Mount of Olives in Acts chapter 1 and go back to heaven. Moses and Elijah. So Jesus here had Moses and Elijah representing the law and the prophets. They came down and the glory of God appeared on this mountain. The disciples were afraid, the three that went up with Jesus, the inner circle, Peter, James, and John, and he just reached over and touched him, and that took care of it. Number six, his touch is a healing touch. The touch of Jesus replaced the servant's ear. Luke chapter 22, verses 50 and 51. And one of them smote the servant of the high priest and cut off his right ear. And Jesus answered and said, suffer you thus far? And he touched his ear and healed him. Now someone asked you, which ear did Simon Peter cut off? Remember, it was his right ear. Now why did Simon Peter cut his ear off? Simon Peter was very impulsive, quick to speak, quick to act. And when they came to take the Lord Jesus, he grabbed his sword and he was going for that man's head. He meant to see his head jump from his shoulders. And when Simon Peter came down with that big sword, no doubt he's a big strong man, Jesus just caused the man to move his head slightly. Instead of his head jumping off his shoulders, only his ear jumped off. Now Jesus reached down and picked that ear up and stuck it back on that man. He touched him, put his ear back on his head. I don't think he even left a scar. Evidently after that, somebody came to take a look at that right ear of that fella. And they said, you know, we don't even see a scar. Now when Jesus does a job, he does it right. Put the man's ear back on his head and man went about his business. And through a touch, he put his ear back on his head. And the Bible tells you so. So the touch of Jesus replaced the servant's ear. Even no scar left, I don't believe. Then we come to thought number seven. And his touch is a saving touch. The touch of Jesus kept Simon Peter from sinking on one occasion, if you remember. In Matthew chapter 14, verses 29 through 31. And he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? And so here we see the saving faith. That is the Son of God reaching out and taking hold of Simon, lifting him up, and kept him from drowning there in the Sea of Galilee. The Sea of Galilee is one of the most beautiful bodies of water that you'll ever lay your eyes on. It's been my privilege to have ridden across the Sea of Galilee some 11 times. I always love it. They're across the Sea of Galilee on a boat. And there on that water, they were out there in the boat, and Jesus came walking toward them. And Simon Peter wanted to walk to Jesus, started walking on the water, and began to sink because he took his eyes off the Son of God and began to look at the waves, started down, and Jesus saved him, just reached out and took hold of him. So the Lord Jesus Christ can save by touch. During the Civil War, there was a young soldier from the South that was wounded and even lost his eyesight. They put him in the hospital in Virginia, but he constantly begged for his mother. And they knew it'd be hard to get his mother there, but day and night he wanted his mother. And so some of the nurses and the officials thought, well, if it's any way possible, let's bring his mother here. During that time, those nurses would go in and they'd place their hands on him and they'd say, this is your mother, what can I do for you? He would not accept that. He said, I want my mother. And finally they reached his mother, put on a train, sent her to Virginia. And she went to the Veterans Hospital and went in, and the boy lying there blind, he could not see. His mother didn't speak a word. She just walked up by his bed and laid her hands on his brow. And the moment she did that, he said, mother, mother, I'm so glad you come. She hadn't spoken a word. He knew the touch of his mother's hand. She had touched his brow before, and he knew that touch. Yes, the touch of the Master's hand makes all the difference in the world. There's something about a touch that's really invaluable. I have a little poem here I want to pass on to you. I think it's very beautiful. I've heard it many times. Maybe you have, but it's so fitting. The touch of the Master's hand. It's about a man auctioning off an old violin. And it says, 'twas battered and scarred, and the auctioneer thought it scarcely worth his while. to waste much time on the old violin, but he held it up with a smile. "What am I beating, good folks?" he cried. "Who started the beating for me? A dollar, now two, only two, $2, and who will make it three? $3 once, $3 twice, going for three, but no." From the room far back, a gray-haired man came forward and picked up the bow. Then wiping the dust from the old violin and tightening up all of its strings, he played a melody pure and sweet as an angel sings. The music ceased, and the auctioneer, with a voice that was quiet and low, said, "What am I bid for the old violin?" And he held it up with the bow. $1,000? Who'll make it two? 2,000? Who'll make it three? 3,000 once? 3,000 twice? And going and gone, said he. The people cheered, but some of them cried. "We do not quite understand. What's changed its worth?" the man replied. "The touch of the master's hand." Now let me give you another little short poem so fitting for us. And many a man with life out of tune and battered and torn with sin is auctioned cheap to a thoughtless crowd, much like the old violin. A mess of pottage, a glass of wine, a game, and he travels on. He's going once, he's going twice, he's going almost gone. But the Lord Jesus comes, and the foolish crowd never quite understand the worth of a soul and the change that's wrought by the touch of the Savior's hand. Have you been touched by the hand of Jesus by faith? If not, there'd be no better time than this day for you to get right with God. There may be somebody out in the radio listening audience. You've lived a terrible life of sin. You feel like your life's been so ensnared and entangled in sin that you just can't get it straightened out. And that may be true, but God can straighten it out. God can straighten your life out. God can untangle those tangles of life. God can do for you what none other can do. What you need is the touch of the Master's hand. There may be someone here today, you say, "Preacher Edwards, I've already been touched by the Master's hand. I'm saved. But my life is powerless. I'm not happy like I used to be." There's still a touch for that. If you come to the Lord Jesus and say, "Oh God, make me what I should be. Give me back my first love and first joy. And touch me for power and touch me for service," God can do that. And I hope God will touch somebody today for salvation and touch somebody today for service in the radio listed audience and even here in this auditorium. We're now in our 37th year of daily broadcasting. And I hope on this day, the second day of our 37th year, that somebody will be touched by the Master's hand. I hope God will use the ministry in the radio listening audience on Sunday morning from 11 to 12 and every day Monday through Saturday at 12 o'clock noon. But if God is speaking to you here in this auditorium, I want you to come forward doing the invitation. Let us help you. If God is speaking out in the radio listening audience, just get on your knees there where you're listening or bow your head and pray the sinner's prayer. If you're not saved, just say, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner, and save me for Jesus' sake." You'll have the touch of the Master's hand. Or if you are saved and you're backslidden on God, there's a little touch that can bring you back into fellowship if you let God touch you today. I trust you will. Thank you. You've listened well. Let's stand to our feet for prayer. Our Father, I pray today that the touch of the Master's hand will be felt by someone in this auditorium and by someone in the radio listening audience today. Thank you. You touched our lives back yonder 40-some-odd years ago. And you're able to touch others today. Now, God, we pray that that touch might be felt, the touch of the Master's hand. We know all things are different whenever we've been touched by the Master's hand. Have you in this invitation for Christ's sake? Amen. While Debbie plays a couple of stanzas on the organ, if you're here in this building, you need to get saved, come back to God. You want to join the church, we receive members. For any other reason you want to come, you may. While we wait, would you obey the Lord and come? Waiting just a moment for you. Would you come? God will touch you today if you let him. Maybe that's just what you need, is a touch of the Master's hand. You've been touched by this world. You've been touched by the devil and his imps. But what you need is a touch of the Master's hand. He can do for you what none other can do. Would you come while we wait?